Professor Dave again, let's continue discussing the Heisenberg uncertainty principle.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
We know that the Heisenberg uncertainty principle limits what can be simultaneously known about the position and momentum of a quantum particle, like an electron. But there is another set of complementary variables that abide by this principle, so we must also investigate how the uncertainty principle relates to energy and time. We can restate the principle mathematically, just as we did before, but instead of x and p, let's put E and T, leaving the rest the same. What this says now is that the uncertainty in the energy of a particle in a certain state times the uncertainty in the interval of time that the particle inhabits that state is greater than or equal to h over 4 pi. If the uncertainty in one of these parameters is very small, that is to say, if one of the two values is very certain, the other becomes increasingly uncertain. So if we know the precise energy of a particle, we don't know how long it has that energy. If we know precisely how long a particle exists in a certain state, we don't know how much energy it possesses. An immediate ramification of this concept brings us possibly the hardest pill to swallow in all of modern physics, the idea of quantum fluctuation. Since it is the case that the shorter the lifetime of a particle, the greater the uncertainty in the energy of the particle, it becomes possible for particles to come into existence from nothing, completely without cause, provided that they exist for inconceivably short durations of time. We call these virtual particles. While it seems like this just can't be true, that it violates causality and everything we thought we knew about the universe, quantum fluctuation of virtual particles is necessary to explain a number of observations, such as the Casimir effect. When two completely neutral plates are placed in a complete vacuum, just a tiny distance away from one another, they will eventually be pushed together. This can't be due to gravity or the electromagnetic force. Instead, we must understand that there are more virtual particles coming into existence on either side of the plates and imparting some force onto them than there are between the plates, so the net force pushes the plates together. Virtual particles arise all the time, everywhere in the universe, subsisting on borrowed energy that is returned when they annihilate a tiny fraction of a second later. Through this phenomenon, we realized that empty space is not empty at all. It is actual substance unto itself. We call this property of space the quantum foam, a sea of probability from which virtual particles manifest and froth. Because of this, empty space actually has measurable energy. This is called the zero-point energy, and it sheds some additional light on the third law of thermodynamics. In classical physics, we understood that any system, including the universe, can never be cooled to absolute zero in a finite number of steps, essentially meaning that absolute zero, a complete absence of kinetic energy, can't be reached. Now we know why. Because there will always be the tiny amount of energy irrevocably contained by space itself, preventing us from peeling away those last few thousandths of a Kelvin. By now you should feel sufficiently confused, possibly on the brink of existential crisis. If this isn't the case, you may not have been paying attention, so you'd better go back and watch again. If you do indeed feel reality spinning away from you, congratulations, you have a small window of insight into how it felt to be a physicist in the early 20th century. It's incredible to think that in just a few decades, we went from thinking physics was essentially complete to having the entire field turned on its head, leaving even the most brilliant people in the field, like Albert Einstein, unable to know what to make of it. But before all of this quantum insanity, there were those three quintessential papers by Einstein in 1905. It was the one on the photoelectric effect that started this mess, but there was another regarding special relativity that is also crucial. Let's talk about that next. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials, support me on Patreon so I can keep making content, and as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.